Okay, so in this session, we'll be discussing about another ILD, that is your organizing pneumonia. Okay, that is your organizing pneumonia. And yes, again, in the same pattern, organizing pneumonia is your histopath and radiology term. Okay, organizing pneumonia. And it's like clinical syndrome that it causes is known as cryptogenic organizing pneumonia. Cryptogenic. Okay. Or simply OP cryptogenic. OP. So this is the now word cryptogenic means idiopathic. Okay, it means unknown cause. So you use cryptogenic OP only when you have ruled out. Okay. Only when rule out other causes. Because it is also associated with other causes, the same causes like drugs, inhalations, toxic fumes, and your collagen vascular disease and so on. Okay. So it is associated with them. Hypersensitive pneumonitis. Okay. Radiation pneumonitis. All those causes. So it is associated. Also, it is also associated with infections. Okay, quite associated. Now, another important point is that what exactly is this organizing pneumonia? Okay. So first of all, its earlier name was, what was its earlier name? And it is also commonly used right now also, current times also. That was this BOOP. That was bronchiolitis. Obliterans sec. Bronchiolitic obliterans organizing pneumonia. Organizing pneumonia is same. Okay, so this was its earlier name, but it was not used right now, and now the term is organizing pneumonia. Why? Because it was giving a false impression that it's an airway disease. That's why this name was dropped. Airway disease. Okay. But here airway involvement is not there. That is why. No airway involvement. That was what dropped, but it is also used commonly right now also. So cryptogenic organizing pneumonia. Now what exactly it is? So it is nothing but, you know, if you talk about the history, clinical or the clinical history of this patient who presents with COP or, you know, or is later diagnosed with COP, how does it happen? Typically, it also happens in your middle age, like 50, 55 years is the average age. So 40, 50 is a typical age, just like if NSP. Okay, this is the age group. And male and female, they are equally affected. And a very important fact that you need to know about this is that, like NSP, NSIP, or your UIP, they are commonly associated with smoking. But here you understand this thing that smoking is not a risk factor. Smoking is not a risk factor. Okay, rather, disease is quite common in non-smokers. Okay. Non-smokers mostly develops COP. Okay, that is one thing. Now, how does it happen actually? So, the classical history is of a respiratory tract infection. Okay, and another important feature that is very specific for this is that is there in history is that we understood that in you know, here also patient will have those symptoms like dry cough, because it's an ILD. We have dry cough, okay, and dyspnea. But relatively, if you see that history of these symptoms is short here, okay, short history, like few weeks only. But when you go about UIP, NSIP, these have a long history, okay? They have a chronic dyspnea, chronic cough. So there's a short history of few weeks, okay? And patient typically has a, you know, preceding case of RTI. So patient has a respiratory tract infection that is followed by, that is resolved. And later patient prone developing as COP. That is something important. Okay, so the symptoms preceded, and that's how it happens. Not resolved exactly, I should not say resolved. The main infection resolves, but what happened? Like say, example patient had a lower respiratory tract infection, but what happens then? The infection goes, but symptoms are there, okay? Patient starts having symptoms, and what symptoms? These symptoms, dry cough and dyspnea, patient start having. So patient, if it's a typical case or classical case, then it gives a history that I had RTI, okay, in the past, and following which I started to have these symptoms, and there's a very, you know, like few weeks it has passed. Now when the patient has RTI, okay, and the picture, if you see the radiological picture of this particular, you know, ILD, the radiological picture of this ILD is also very, you know, it looks like a basically a mnemonic picture, like a pneumonia. Okay, it looks like a pneumonia, like a bacterial pneumonia, or the, because there are patchy consolidations and all, okay, and nodules. It looks like an airspace or pastry that is, you know, patchy. But to be very precise, actually, it's not infection. It's not an infection. Yeah, infection precedes it, but the response or the immunogenic response of the body to that particular infection is actually fibrotic. Okay, that's why the word organizing is there. Because what happens is that, yeah, definitely it's a airspace disease, because things or the occupying of airspace happens. It's an airspace disease. That's why the consolidation happens actually in disease. Consolidation will only happen when the airspace is occupied. So, but the occupying of airspace is not by the inflammatory exudate, rather it is by fibroblastic cells. Okay, fibroblastic cells, they occupy it. So that is the point, that is why, you know, it's organized. So the consolidation is nothing but it's a fibrotic area, you know, or the fibrotic cells that are occupying that typical, you know, okay. So that is what, that is why fibrotic proliferation which result from organization, okay. And now it's basically an abnormal response. Let's say if patient had a, you know, patient had pneumonia and patient had consolidation that time, okay, let's say patient has a typical pneumonia, like a bacterial pneumonia, patient had consolidation. Now after consolidation, the exudate that was occupying this, you know, it should have gone away, but it responds by proliferating of fibrocytes. So if the fibrotic response starts in response to that, okay, then it becomes a organizing pneumonia or cryptogenic organizing pneumonia if you do not have any cause, okay. That's what it is. So it's basically airways and air spaces are involved with fibroblastic proliferation. That's what it is histopathologically. And rest of the important thing is that typically you have history of RTI. That's what I've told, just okay. And patient have, you know, patient develops, this is a typical history patient gets, and that's all about it. Now another important thing is that this patient, you know, another thing that is very, you know, classical about this is that a patient obviously, when patient developed RTI, patient would have taken antibiotics as well. Okay, so doctor generally run an antibiotic course, because, you know, picture is like a consolidation is there on the, you know, X-ray or CT. So patient has a, you know, an apparently a bacterial picture, but what happens is that even after giving an antibiotics, patient ultimately go on developing these symptoms of, you know, few weeks of dry cough and dyspnea. And patient doesn't get recovered completely. The antibiotic response is not there. Response to antibiotics is not there. So that is where, you know, you should start suspecting organizing pneumonia if you have a picture corresponding to this particular, and you have classical patterns that I'll discuss in a few minutes. If you have these pictures or classical pictures over radiology regarding this particular and coexistent with this typical clinical history, then you should start suspecting organizing pneumonia, because the poor response to antibiotics is one point, is a clinching point, which suggests that now, you know, that inflammatory exudate has, you know, disappeared, but the organizing fibroblastic cells are proliferating. That is causing the consolidation to persist. Okay, so in that case, the treatment of this organizing pneumonia is basically steroids. Patients started on steroids, and you will not feel surprised that within 3 months patient gets okay. It's a quite a good response on steroids, and that is why it is important to suspect and have a high clinical suspicion of a non-resolving consolidation, something like that. So, okay. Now, next thing is that we should enter about the radiology. Okay, and other thing is that you had the symptoms not only pertaining to chest. You also have constitutional symptoms. Okay, along with that, respiratory symptoms. Now, important thing is that regarding your radiology, that we need to know, and what are the patterns commonly that we see in this particular type of ILD. So typically it could be unilateral, multilateral, unilateral, bilateral, obviously. And I just told you that what type of opacities you have. You have airspace opacities. Okay, airspace opacities here. So it's an interstitial pneumonia. Yeah, definitely interstitial involvement is also there. Okay, and one of the pattern is quite common. Basically, airspace opacity is there because fibroblastic proliferation is there. Okay, in the your organizing pneumonia. Okay, or granulation tissue is there, whatever it is. But there is a airspace opacity. So airspace opacities are two. Either it's a GGO or either it could be consolidation. Now, classically, if you see, consolidations are the dominant factor. You will see consolidation commonly. So what are the patterns? Patterns of organizing pneumonia. The first pattern you should understand is your patchy consolidation. Patchy consolidation or GGOs. Okay, so consolidations are obviously more. Okay, consolidation more common than GGOs. Okay, and what is the location? Location, remember, is what? Peribronchial, meaning, and subpleural. So subpleural peribronchial location. Recall your secondary pulmonary nodule. Subpleural and peribronchial. So obviously, this is subpleural area, and this is your secondary pulmonary nodule. So peribronchial location would be central lobular. So what they are saying, basically, they are nothing saying that they are saying subpleural centrilobular location is what they are saying. So you will have peripheral or subpleural consolidation or GGOs. Okay. Now, second important point, it could be, now either you have consolidation or GGOs, or either you can have nodules. You can have nodules also. Now, the nodules are also in the same location. Location is same. Okay. Same locations. Now, these nodules, either they can be small or they can be large nodules as well. Okay, of several sizes, they can be large, but they are typically subpleural centrilobular. Okay, another third possibility is that you can have focal or large or lobar consolidation. That is another thing. Focal or lobar consolidation is one thing that you should remember. So that is also another possibility. And what is the next pattern? Next pattern is, there are two more patterns that are left. Next pattern is your reverse atoll sign, reverse hello sign, reverse hello sign, or atoll sign. Now, what exactly it is? I have discussed it in eosinophilic pneumonia as well. The video will be uploaded soon. So, reverse hello sign. Now, you see commonly what you see. You see a solid area in the center, and you see a ground glassing at the periphery. Now, this is what a classical hello sign would be. This is like a hello sign. Now, if you reverse it, okay, so GGO become in the center and the solid part becomes in the periphery, then it will be called as reverse hello sign, and the same sign is known as atoll sign. So you see like this, this is solid part and this is your GGO that is in the center. So this is your reverse hello. So you will see these hellos also. This particular sign is seen with this. I'll show the image also. And the last pattern you see is your perilobular pattern. Now this pattern can mimic NSIP, parilobular pattern. What exactly it is? See, why? Because it, you know, what you will see that, let's say this is your secondary pulmonary lobule. What happens is basically, now you have, this is your central dot, okay, of pulmonary artery, and you have bronchioles here, and here is what you have, air spaces. So this is the area which is typically involved by cryptogenic organism pneumonia, because here is what your air spaces are there, and the, you know, fibroblastic proliferation and granulation tissue proliferates in these areas only. So what happens is, at the periphery also, when where there is interlobular septa, what happens, the fibroblast gets deposited at this point also. So what happens, due to the deposition at the periphery of the lobule, what happens, it mimics as if the interlobular septa has thickened, okay, it has thickened, but it's not interlobular septal thickening, it's a mimicking, it's basically mimicking of interlobular septal thickening, interlobular septal thickening. Okay, that is what is in parallel pattern. So you will see it like an SIP. Now, characteristically, what you will see that even if you have interlobular septal thickening, okay, and you, and also what is the distribution? What is the distribution in of organizing pneumonia? So commonly it involves lower lobes. Lower lobes are involved. Okay, so if lower lobes are involved and parallel pattern, you see you may mimic an SIP, but in NSIP typical. Typically, you see GGOs. You can see consolidation in later phase, but typically, you see GGOs. Okay, in NSIP, I told you. So, in perilobular pattern, but you will see when you see consolidation. Okay, when you see consolidation, you have a classical history also. Then start suspecting this, which suggests organizing pneumonia. Yeah. Okay. And lower lobes are involved more than upper lobes, because upper lobes can also involve. So, there is a gradient there. In NSIP, the gradient is lost. Okay, now if you know another thing, okay, I'll be uploading a video on eosinophilic lung disease as well in a short period of time. But you know, in eosinophilic lung disease, there's a very important entity, that one of the few important entities that you need to know is chronic eosinophilic pneumonia. Okay, and in chronic eosinophilic pneumonia also, I have discussed the same patterns or same five patterns that are seen in organizing pneumonia, and they have overlapping patterns. Okay, so you diagnose it only when, if you have peripheral blood or tissue eosinophilia, evidence of these, any of these two, then the diagnosis becomes chronic eosinophilia. Now I have written again at this location, which is not visible mostly, so should remember. So in chronic eosinophilic pneumonia also, okay, in chronic eosinophilic pneumonia also, if you know, you have similar five patterns. The only differentiating thing is that peripheral blood or tissue eosinophilia is there, and that is what is the clinching factor. This is the thing that will diagnose it. It's also like organizing pneumonia only. Okay, so that is a major DD. Chronic eosinophilic pneumonia is a major DD of organizing pneumonia. Chronic eosinophilic pneumonia. Okay, so remember this thing also. Now, can you have honeycombing here? Can you have reticular opacity there? Yeah, we can have, but the chances are very less. Okay, very, very little. Okay, only few cases. We can have small pleural effusions as well, but they're very little. So predominantly you need to know only this, the patch areas of consolidations and all. Another important point that we need to understand is, okay, that so typically like this, and these nodules that we see, that the third pattern we, you know, understood about here, you know, third pattern was nodules. So these nodules can cavitate also. So if you see, you know, it gives a typical appearance of an infection, but antibiotics, you know, they do not show any response, and that is why you should start suspecting about this COP. Okay, otherwise, you know, there are some atypical patterns also in which you might need a biopsy ultimately to diagnose it. Okay, that's what it is. Sometimes, you know, there may be a solid nodule which will appear like a lung cancer, but ultimately it is COP only. So that's what it is, like COP. And now look at the images. One important point that I need to share here is that COP is also, although I have told it also in my eosinophilic lung disease section, okay, that COP is one of the differential is one of the differential, and we discussed the differentials for fleeting opacities, or that opacities that migrate, they change their positions. So COP is one cause of migratory opacities. These opacities, that is the consolidation, can change its position even without treatment. Okay, so remember this thing. Now look at the images. Look at the images of COP. Now this one image, okay, so you can clearly see subpleural area getting involved. Okay, subpleural area getting involved, and so see subpleural area getting involved, and what you are seeing, you are seeing nodules. They appear to be nodules. Subpleural peribronchial nodules are there. Okay, that is one pattern, and they appear to be small pattern only, small nodules only. So okay, now look at the next pattern. See this pattern. Now in this pattern, you can clearly see these are the large areas of what? Consolidations, and they are peripheral. They're peripheral. Now this is cavitating consolidation. Cavitation also seen here. Typically, and it's a unilateral picture. So unilateral case can have also come. So it's a peripheral, you know, peripheral, typically subpleural area consolidations are there. Okay. And it looks like mid part of the lung. That is one thing. That is also one pattern. Now this is your typical, atoll sign. Okay. This is your typical atoll sign. If you look closely, or you look this also, so this is GGO in the center. GGO surrounding is your center. So you have GGO here, and this is your solid part. This part is solid. This is a solid part, and this is your ground glass part. So see GGO in the center and solid in the periphery. That's what it is, your typical atoll sign that is seen here. Then you see this. Now you can clearly see here at this point, this is a perilobular pattern. You can see I think there is bronchiectasis also here a little bit, but you can clearly see these are what? Interlobular septa. Interlobular septa thickening. It looks like this, and there is this consolidation with this. So we have consolidation also. Consolidation also, consolidation, interlobular septal thickening. Okay, so it's like a perilobular pattern. So, you know, things are very dicey here. Like, for example, if you see this, there are also peripheral consolidations. There are few areas of GGOs also, but it mostly appears like a consolidation. So, classical picture is of a consolidation. Remember this thing. Either you see consolidation, you do not see much of the GGOs. GGOs are quite less here. On the hand, GGOs are a predominant feature in NSIP. But in organizing pneumonia, consolidation is the most predominant feature. Okay. Okay. That is about organizing pneumonia. Okay. And I don't think anything is left in this, the predominant sign. So basically, what is the message that needs to be conveyed is that always in chest radiology, you know, clinical history and other adjoining things, they are quite important, and the importance lies only on one thing, to diagnose. Okay, because you know patterns are so overlapping. Like for example, you see organizing pneumonia and CEP. The only differentiating feature is the lab investigation, that is your eosinophilia, and the patterns are all almost same. Similarly, if the patient is having, let's say, perilobular pattern coming with GGO, you know, it may later be diagnosed on biopsy to be OP, and you are suspecting on radiology to be NSIP. Although differentiating between NSIP and OP is not that much, because you know ultimately you require steroids only and the treatment is same. So only for the academic purposes it is important, but differentiating between UIP and other ILDs is quite important, because it's not only the academic purpose that is served, it's actually the patient prognosis is widely, you know, widely separated or widely different from other UIP is widely different from other ILDs. So here it is not that much important, but yeah, you know, you can suspect OP when, you know, typically you have a consolidation, you know, that is not getting resolved on antibiotics, and you have a history of RTI following which the patient had symptoms. So patient had a chronic dyspnea, a short history of chronic dyspnea that is there. But if the patient, you know, typically has a bacteria, you will always suspect bacterial pneumonia as a first DD. Okay, you will not obviously directly jump to OP unless you see some clear-cut clinical signs that there is a patchy consolidation that is peripheral and there is no response to antibiotics. Then only start the patient on steroids thinking it's OP, or you go for a biopsy first to diagnose that is OP. Okay, so that is all about organizing pneumonia. Thank you.